Okay, so this is, so if you recall, the today's lecture is, number is 9. So if you, this is okay, you are able to see. So this is, so if you have a point P and around point P we have drawn a parallelepiped of delta x, this side is delta x, this side is delta y and this side is delta z. We have drawn a small element, three dimensional element, which we call it parallelepiped or parallelepiped, whatever you want to pronounce it. So this is, the sides are different, otherwise it is a cube. So since sides are different, so it is all angles are 90. So we have drawn a small parallelepiped around point P, and we would like to express, we would like to show the what is the stress that exists at point P. Now exists because the stress is acts on a plane. So that is why we have drawn this parallelepiped. Because if you just simply take point P, how will you draw a plane? So around point P, we have drawn a small element, and which has got now six planes. So you have x plane. This is our positive x plane. So on this positive x plane, this is a, what are the stresses that are acting? So one stress will be, I have already defined what are so on this plane, x plane, these will be the three directions in which the stresses will be acting, three components of the stress, and this stress component will be sigma x, this will be tau xy. This will be tau xz. So this is on a x plane. When you go to y plane, this I have already done last time, so I am just repeating. On a y plane, on a positive y plane, the stress directions will be positive in the positive coordinate direction. See, these are all the positive directions. So this is a positive stress. We define positive stress acting on a plane. So outward normal is in x direction, so it is a positive x plane, and these are the positive stresses. So here the stress directions will be this and this. Now this one will be the normal stress, this will be yz, and this will be tau yx. Now this is a positive z plane, and the directions are x, y, z. So the which one is the normal? That this one is the normal stress, sigma z. This one will be tau z y, and this will be tau z x. So on a positive plane, I have shown you what are the stresses that are acting, and these are, I think I have already told you, that this forms the six components of the stress tensor, and tensor is a quantity which has got nine components, like, and this one is called second order tensor. A second order tensor has got nine components, there are nine quantities, and they can be, then if you take, this is on the positive coordinate planes, all stresses. On positive coordinate now what happens on the negative two? which one is a negative explain? Negative explain is this one. Outward normal, this face, that is back side of this. This is the front face and the back side is this. So I am just putting it. So if you draw an outward normal, it will be like this. In the negative x direction, so this is a negative x plane, because outward normal is going in the negative x direction. So on a negative plane, all stresses will be positive if they act in the negative direction. So what are the negative direction? This is, and that is the requirement. So this will be an x, so this one will be sigma x, this will be tau x xz, and this will be tau x y. Now which one is a negative? This is a positive y plane, this one is a negative y plane, so this one, this is the y direction but negative, so negative direction, so this is negative and this is, so these are the three stresses that are acting there, three stress components, the stresses, three stress components, and then this one will be sigma y tau yz and tau yx. This is the positive z plane, negative z plane is this bottom one. So this one is, because this is in the negative z direction. So the negative directions are this. So this one will be sigma z. This will be zy. This will be tau z x. So these are stress components. Acting on negative okay. So it must be very clear, and if you take both these, I mean I have drawn it purposely and two so that there is no confusion, this is on a positive and this is on a negative, they will all be equal and opposite. So they will keep the element in equilibrium. So this is the reason why the sign convention is, you have to follow this positive plane, negative plane, what is a positive? So positive stresses are all acting on positive and negative planes and they are keeping the element in equilibrium. Because if you see this, the equilibrium will be maintained, you know. This is, for example, sigma y is acting here, sigma y is acting here in this direction. Area is same, so force will be same. Similarly, this, any direction you take, so all will be, they will all be cancelling each other. All forces, sum of forces will be zero. So this will, element will remain in equilibrium. Now this is, what is most important is, this is at a point. So when we say, tell me what is the stress at this point in the body, so you have to draw this parallelepiped and find out these six components. So that we call the state of stress, the difference between just telling stress and state of stress. State of stress at a point P is given by the following six components. Okay. So it is a tensor quantity, it follows certain rule. Tensor is different from vector because there is orientation of area is involved. And another thing, see at the same point, I have taken an element which is oriented along XYZ. XYZ. Now it is up to you to draw XYZ in any manner you like. It need not be like this. Next one, I can draw this my x, y, z, my parallelepiped will be like this. I will call this x dash, y dash, z dash. Yes. At the same point, I have changed the orientation of my parallelepiped. And now these are my new coordinates, orthogonal coordinates. So now you have again got, so these stresses, for example, y plane, this will be sigma y, tau y, z, but I will put here now z dash, because this is with reference to a new coordinate system, y dash, z dash. Similarly, this one will be y dash, then this one will be tau y x, both dashes. So that means there will be infinite set of stresses, six components at the same point. It all depends upon the way you take your parallelepiped, what is the orientation of the, so there is nothing like, you have to fix your coordinate and say with reference to this coordinate, this is my stress tensor. Now you will find, I mean that can be proved, because there are certain things that I am not proving, I am only telling you the result. One thing I told you, that the stress tensor is symmetric, tau ij, any x, y, I and j will always be equal to tau j I. I and j, x, y, z, j also is x, y. So we call it complementary. The shear stresses are complementary to each other. Tau x, y equal to tau y, x, tau y z equal to tau z y, and so on. So this can be proved. You know, I am not proving it. So from these 9 components, tensor has got 9, is it not? 3 by 3, 3 by 3 matrix has got how many quantities? 3 and 3, 9 quantities. Because it becomes symmetric, so only 6 are independent. It is symmetric now. So 3 quantities, normal stresses are normal, they will be independent. But the shear stresses are complementary to each other. So you get 3 more, so 6. So only 6 are independent. So if you know 6 components, then you can say that state of stress at that point is known. Further, it is possible to transform, once you know the state of stress with reference to x, y, z, it is possible to compute in terms of these quantities, which are dashes. That is also possible. So we can transform. So once you have found out with reference to one coordinate system, yes, you change the coordinate, it can be transformation. So you can transform it. So this is, you don't have to worry. So when we say, please find out the state of stress, compute the state of stress, means we have to compute all the 6 components. Okay. This is when the body is 3-dimensional, when the body is general body. Now, if the body is not general, but it is a special body, let us say I am talking of a sheet of paper. When I am talking of the entire this sheet of paper, that means this has got thickness also. Some you can measure, you know, at least this will be 1 centimeter thickness. So it's not less, it has got some dimension. But now if I consider only, so that will be 3-dimensional body. But if I consider only one sheet of paper, the thickness is very, very small compared to this dimension and this dimension. So such a body where one dimension is very, very small compared to the other two, we call it 2-dimensional body, not 3-dimensional. So this is, I have told you, state of stress in 3-dimensional body. So this is in 3D. 3-dimensional body. 3D. But if the body itself is 9-3, if the body itself is special, so body is thin membrane or paper. Thickness is very small. So it is in the plane of your paper. Thickness is so small that I can consider now it. So it is all the points in this body, and the thickness is very, very small. So thickness is not important. So now I can refer all the points of this body with reference to only the Cartesian system of coordinate, all right. But Z is not important. X, Y, so that is why I have put it here. This normal Z, X, Y itself, so point P as coordinate, Z is not, Z becomes insignificant. In that case, what kind of element you should draw around the, so around point, any point P, what will you draw? Yes, I will draw a small, a rectangular element of delta x and delta y size, because I have to define the state of stress at point P in a two-dimensional body, and if this body is subjected to loads that are also acting in the same plane, xy plane only, nothing is acting perpendicular to the plane, everything is confined to xy. So thickness is small, Z dimension is small, loads are all acting in only XY plane. There is no load that is perpendicular to XY. So in that case, how will you define your state of stress at point P? First of all, my element becomes a two-dimensional element. So this is a two-dimensional body. So we call such a body as two-dimensional. Third dimension is insignificant. So once I have this element, I'm taking it out around point P. Then which one is X plane? Yes, this one, of course, there is some thickness. So this is my positive X plane, this is positive Y plane, this is negative X, this is negative Y. Is it okay? So on a positive X plane, what are the stresses that are acting? There will be, yes, the components of stress will be, one will be normal, so we'll call it later. Other one, because Z direction, I told you, is insignificant, very, very thin. So nothing will be there in Z, because all the loads are only in XY. So there is nothing to balance in Z direction. Z direction is, there is no load, so nothing to balance. So no stresses, stress components will be there in the Z direction. Z direction is this, is perpendicular to the plane. So here, the next stress will be, should it point downwards or upwards? Positive. Positive means on a positive plane, stresses will be positive in the positive direction. What is positive direction? What will be its name? I mean, tau xy. Go here. So this one will be sigma y. And then what is the positive? So only two components will be acting on each edge. The thickness of the edge is very, very small. Delta Z is small. On a negative X, this will be sigma x in the negative direction, and what will be the positive shear stress, upwards or down stress? Down in the negative direction. So this one will be tau x y, this one will be sigma y on a negative plane, and what will be the in a negative direction? So this is the direction. So this will be tau y x. So this is the state of stress at point P in a two-dimensional body which is subjected to loads that are confined to xy plane only in two dimensions. Thickness of this body in z direction is very, very small. I told you the example of, I gave you the example of this sheet of paper. Everything is like this, and the loads are you are pulling, pushing, you know, within the plane. No load perpendicular, okay, all are. So such a, so this is now given by these, how many are there, how many components? Two normal stresses and two shear stresses, four. And what is most important is you must see this direction over here and over here. They must be at any corner, at any corner, they must be, see, for example, this corner, they are going away, both the directions. This corner, both the, they are going away, but this corner, they are, okay, so shear stresses, don't draw like this, one direction like this, this direction like this, this direction like this, no, it will not be, then it will be rotate, the element will not be in equilibrium, you know, it will start rotating, there will be rotation. So this will keep the element in equilibrium. So now the components are sigma x, sigma y, tau xy and tau yx. Now z direction, z dimension, not direction, z dimension is very, very small compared to x and y dimensions. Are you able to follow this body? My pronunciation is very colloquial. I have lived in UK, Europe for several years, but I could not change my pronunciation. Some people go for 6 months and they come with a very different accent. I do not know what do they do. Okay, so this is, and then again this we can prove, I have told you already, shear stresses are always complementary to each other. Complementary means these two will be equal. Tau xy will be equal to tau yx. So here, the state of stress will be defined at any point only by three components, two normal and one shear stress. While in a three-dimension body, the state of stress at any point will be defined by six quantities, three normal stresses and three shear stresses. And you must practice drawing these stresses on different directions. Again here, somebody has drawn this at this body, xy like this. But you can also take your next, this one, 9, 5. This is the body. I can take my coordinates x dash, y dash, and therefore my element. I can take my element like this around point P. So at the same point P is the same, but now the coordinate direction only is orientation is different, but the point is same. So, but then this will all be different. your values will be different. At least you should draw these things correctly. This one will be tau y dash x like this. We will so this is a two dimensional body, and here we are left only with we can always this is possible. We will see it little later. This is possible. We can always relate the two. Transformation. We can transform one with reference to the other. In terms of, we can express all these quantities in terms of these three quantities and vice versa. So here also it is possible. So once you have found out with reference to one set of coordinates, you can always find out with reference to any other that is possible. Okay, so I think I will stop here the discussion about state of stress at a point. I gave you the generalization of concept of stress, because first we started with uniaxial state of stress. Now I have given you general state of stress, because this is important. Now let us go to, so far we have dealt with problems. For example, we did solve this problem, if I remember this right, a problem of this type. And if I subjected to a load here or a load over here, supposing I give a load over here, a load there, so this is P1, this is P2, this is again uniaxial, so this is L1, this is L2, area of cross section is A1, area of cross section here is A2, so everything is modulus of velocity here is E1, here it is E2. You can also think of two different materials, two different, each one is homogeneous. Each one is one material, top one bigger cylinder, then, and cross section let us say is circular. Cross section is circular. I am sure you can solve this. You can find out the state of stress. Here the portion of state doesn't, it is a uniaxial. This, the whole body is subjected to uniaxial state. So there is only one stress component at any point, and that is a normal stress. So you can find out normal stress. Can you? What you do? You have to, and especially in this problem, P1, P2, these are the center points of L2 and L1. So these are at which it is. So for example, this problem, start from here. What is the value of, from here? What is the load acting on cross section over here. If I draw a free body diagram here, I want to know what is the shear load. Yes, this whole composite column. I mean, this is a rod which is hanging of two different cross sections. It will have some deformation also. You know, it will come down. It will have some under the action of load. It will come down, and it will be under stress and strain. So what is the stress over here, or what is the load? First, anyway, you have to find out the load subjective. What is the load from here, from this point, next cross section, next up to this, to the just bottom of this where the load is applied. Up to here, let me draw a bigger. So there is no load. I have cut a cross section just below this. Is there any load that is this length is subjected to? So I will call this, what should I call? There is no load here. Is it okay? So in this region, from here to here, there is no load. So this is P equal to 0. P equal to 0. Is it clear? Free body diagram. You have to draw free body diagram. So I have drawn free body diagram. This is from the bottom. Best thing is to draw from one side, you know, because here you know there is no load. So let me cut it. How this will remain in equilibrium? So here there is no load. It is simply hanging on its own. There is no external load, and we are not considering self weight. Self weight of the material is very very small. We are considering only these external loads that are applied. Self weight is 0. Now take a cross section over here. That means I want to take the free body diagram. When load is here, P1. What is? So this will be this is P2. So what is the load acting over here at this cross section? P2. So there will be a reaction. At this cross section, the load acting is P2. And that will continue to any cross section up to here till A2 is there. Now go in A1. You take also a now cross section up to here, just below P1. That means I'm drawing now a free body diagram of this portion is complete. This is P2, and this one is just below where P1 is applied. So just now you told me that over here the load acting in this is P2, is it not? From here to here is P2. Now you come here. What will be the load over here? P2 only. Only area of cross section has changed. Area of cross section has become A1. But the load here is P2. Is it clear? Free body diagram is very important and you must practice. So one portion. So first one, we drew this. This is my first. This is my second case. This is my third case. Three sections I have taken. And the other section now I will take is after this. Supposing you cut it over here till this point, till just below the support. So if you cut it, that means almost the entire rod. So you have P P2 over here, P1 in the center over here, and when I take this from here, it will start directly from here. So what will be the reaction here, please, at any cross section? It will be P1 plus P2. In order to keep this in equilibrium, it will be P1 plus P2. They are all uniaxial, they are all. And then finally, when you go over here, this remove the support, you have the reaction. Reaction also comes out to be P1 and P2. So reaction. So when you remove this, I mean total. Total. There must be a reaction. This reaction is. So you see, you are able to compute this reaction directly from equilibrium. Because in order to maintain the equilibrium, if you write R and vertical equilibrium, if you take R plus P1 plus P2 must be equal to 0. So direction of R also will come out to be opposite. P1 plus P2 are downwards. So R will automatically come out to be upwards in order to maintain equilibrium. And the value will be P1 plus P2 because sum of forces must be 0 in the vertical. So such problems where you have least number of constraints in order to maintain the equilibrium of the body. See, this is, you have hung the rod from top. You need only one constraint. It must be supported from top. Then I can hang it. This one, it must be hung from here. So only one constraint is needed. Such problems, and there, the number of unknown reaction was only one. It turns out to be because this is only one reaction. And you have got only one equation of equilibrium. So you can find it out. So such problems where number of equations of equilibrium and number of reactions, support reactions, constraint reaction, they are called by different names. Support reactions are constraint. Support is constraint. You are constraining the body. So remove the constraint, there will be a reaction. Okay, free body diagram will give you a reaction. So such problems where number of reactions and number of equilibrium equations, they match, they are equal. That means you are able to solve the problem for the reaction. Such problems are called what? Statically determinate such problems. You have done this? Where did you do this? Last, in the engineering mechanics. Okay. But you may not have solved such problems, but that was with reference to rigid body. Yes, but such problems are called statically determinate, because statical equilibrium equations are, the number of statical equilibrium equations. Here it happens to be only one and one reaction. So you are able to solve. So statically determinate. Statically determinate. So why I have taken 10 minutes to explain this problem. So this is a statically determinate problem. Simple. This problem is statically determinate, and you are able to find out the force that is acting in each and every portion. So for example, in this problem, now how will you solve this? Yes, this is 9-7. So now I will see, now I will draw only the will not clutter the diagram with number of details. I will only show what are the, these lengths are L1 and L2, and the loads are acting in the center. But I will not show. I will only say that now I have divided this into four zones. From here to here, load is zero. There is no, this portion is not subjected to any load. Is it clear? Now from here to, why I am dividing this, although from here to here it is subjected to same load. Is it clear? From this point, just above this point and just below this point, it is subjected to the same load. But still I am dividing this into this portion because the area of cross section is changing. So I am saying from here to here again, the load is how much? P2. It is P2. This is subjected to a tensile load of P2, tensile. That to everything is tensile here, simple. I have not shown this load here now. I'm only saying from here to here, the load everywhere is P2. Again, from here to here, the load, tensile load is how much? P2. Of course, area of cross section. And from here to here, the load, again tensile. See, tensile is always shown by a positive sign. Since I am not showing any negative, so it is tensile load. So here to here the load is P1 plus P2. So very simple. So it is four zones, A, B, C and D. So what is stress in A? Zero, load is zero divided by A2. Zero. Normal stress in A means this zone, zero. Normal stress in B is P2 divided by A2. Clear? Then this C, normal stress anywhere in C from here to here, this zone is how much? P2 divided by A1. See, there is a change of cross section. So, which stress will be more, here or here? At this interface, where will stress be more, here or here? In B, because area of cross section is reducing suddenly. So, there is a sudden jump. It reduces from P2 by A2 is be a large quantity because A2 is smaller than A1. So A1 will be, so there will be jump here. Normally stress will jump here, sudden jump. So that means this is a point of what? Stress concentration. Wherever you have jumps, you have, you know, suddenly you cannot see, just you cross this point, cross this junction, and the stress is increasing as you come down. Go up, stress is as reduced by half or 1/4, whatever it is. So, like this, so this is a zone of stress concentration. And sigma D is P1 plus P2 divided by A. So, stress you have found out in all the four zones. So, state of stress is known. Can you also find out strains, please? uniform, what is the strain in each one of these? You know the stress. So strain is very easy. Yes. So strain, for example, start from here. So strain means normal strain in A, normal strain in B, normal strain in C, and normal strain in D. Will what? Stress divided by modulus of elasticity, E1. So for example, here A, this is 2. So this one will be sigma A, that means it is 0 anyway. Sigma A divided by what? E2. This one will be sigma B divided by E2. This will be sigma C divided by, and this one will be sigma D. So strains also are changing, and then this is will be given by this, because the stress you know, so you can find out the strain. What about change in length? This rod will undergo some deformation. This is all subjected to tensile load, so it will elongate. What is this? Delta. Yes, what is delta? What is delta? Yes, please. Quickly. You have to find, I want to know what is delta. Change in length of this entire composite rod. Yes. So first one here. What is change in, this one? This is because this whole thing will come as a rigid body. From here to here, this is not subjected to any load. So no strain, no stress. So this part will come as a rigid body. Is it clear? But here it is not so. This is elongating. So the first part will be delta. So delta is, first part is 0 first. Then next one. No, but what is the load? P2. In this portion, what is the load? P2. What is the length? So P2. What is the length? L2 by 2. L2 by 2, no? This one, this is L2 by 2. What is area of cross section? A2. What is PL by AE? This portion is subjected to a load of P2, and its whose length is L2 by 2, modulus of elasticity of E2, area of cross section is A2. So this one will undergo extension of this amount. So this is the extension. So this can be written as delta A. This one will be delta B. This portion, this is delta B. What is delta C? Delta C is here, this portion. What is the load it is subjected to? P2. What is the length? L1 by 2. area of cross section A1, modulus of velocity E1. Is it clear? This portion. So this portion will elongate this portion. If you simply take this, this will elongate by delta C. What about delta D? What is delta D? What is the load? P1 plus P2. What is length? Okay, is it clear? So this will give you the total. So delta is summation of all the smaller deltas. Of each portion, you have to find out what is the delta change in length of each portion where which is subjected to constant load. We also write this in general such formula as different zones are subject. Let us say there are n zones, I going from 1 to into Li by Ai Ei. I going from 1 to n. Here n is 4. In our case, n is 4. I can have a general formula, summation. It is summation. So there are different zones. So I have divided this into 4 zones. And then, and each one of these 4 zones is subjected to a constant load and whose area of cross-section, length, etc. are uniform. So they can be found out from this. So remember this, this can be done like this. So you have solved this completely. But this problem was statically determinate. Determinate. Supposing in the same problem, now you think about it, I will not do it. This problem, this is the problem. Supposing the bottom end is not free, but it is also fixed. It is also supported. And loads are same P1 and P2. Then what will happen? So we'll solve the same problem in the next class when bottom one also will be constrained. Now we have solved only a determinate problem, and then you think about it, how to solve this. You have to do the same thing. You find out the stress, strain,